Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. I am very excited to be introducing Anad from Isha Outreach, and he is in charge of our New Calvary Calling Project. He can introduce himself and tell us a little more about what his role is within the organization and who Isha is. Greetings, Anad.
Namaskaram to everyone. My name is Anand. I'm basically from the southernmost part of India in a place called Trichy, which is in the state Tamil Nadu. And basically, I would like to call myself as a farmer by choice. And I basically did sustainable agriculture for a period of 7-8 years. And in 2005, when I heard about an opportunity to work with Sadhguru, who is the founder of Isha Foundation, a nonprofit international charitable organization, which is focusing on spiritual well-being for people, I had an opportunity to be a part of this organization to volunteer and plant trees. And the experience of planting trees with community participation is what made me stay with Isha Foundation since 2005 until date. And I could say that more than half of my life has been with this organization. And I am a full-time volunteer, like many thousands of them are as part of the foundation. And I represent the environmental initiatives of the foundation. Basically, we have a program, erstwhile program under the banner of Project Green Hands, and which later on grew up into a larger initiative called Rally for Rivers. And as Rally for Rivers gained more and more momentum, we have taken up one of the world's largest demonstration programs with a time-tested and a ground-proven technology of agroforestry at a scale that it has not been precedented before in a short span of time. So this initiative is called Kaveri Calling, which I'll be talking in more detail with all of you. So coming to Tara's question, who's Isha? Isha is basically the name of the organization, Isha Foundation. So Isha Foundation was started in 1992, and it was registered as a charitable organization, non-profit organization. And we started imparting yoga as one of the fundamental offerings to the larger humanity. And the fundamental thing is that if inner well-being is taken care, rest of it can be easily engineered. So that's the fundamentals of Sadhguru taking up a program called Inner Engineering, which has reached millions of people across the globe, and especially in India. And in 2009, after Isha Foundation's work in rural sector for imparting yoga as well as planting trees, attending to the medical necessities of remote villages in Tamil Nadu, and also building education programs for rural children. I mean, English medium, highly, high quality education program for rural children under, you can say, almost 95% scholarship. So these kind of initiatives started from 2003. And in 2009, when the foundation saw that the scope and the possibility of touching more and more lives through social outreach projects beyond the spiritual offerings of the foundation, Sadhguru decided to start an entity called Isha Outreach. So Isha Outreach is also a non-profit charitable organization which is focusing on the three fundamental social outreach programs in the area of health, environment, and education. So me being a part of the environmental division of Isha, I'm here to share my experiences and whatever questions that Tara has for me. So Tara, please proceed.
Thank you so very much. That was really helpful to understand the flow of how Isha came into being and where it's going now. And I know that we have been very happy to participate in the Project Green Hands through some funding of the program and how successful that's been. And my understanding is some of the lessons that you learned there have kind of formed this new project, Calvary Calling. And I'd love to help the network that's watching this to understand what were those things that you learned and how did you apply it to this project? What is this, actually also, what is this current situation that is happening and why this particular project is so important.
Yeah. Though Kaveri Calling is a new brand name that we have coined since 2019 when Sadhguru initiated a motorcycle rally to raise the awareness of the local farmers and the local civil societies to join hands together to find a workable nature-based solution for the river, which is in dying state. Though the name was coined in 2019, basically it's just a scale-up of what Project Green Hands has been doing since 2005. So if you see, what is our key learnings? So the fundamental objective of Project Green Hands when we started in 2004 was that we wanted to bring permanent green cover. I just wanted to insist the terminology permanent green cover, because green cover includes plantation crops and various other agriculture activities. When I say permanent green cover, I talk about trees that will live beyond probably 20, 30, 40, 50 years, and they will serve the community in terms of multiple benefits, in terms of food for people, fodder for animals, timber for furniture, and various other uses that we are actually in need of. And if we look at India subcontinent, more than you could say 80% of the land's tree cover has completely gone. And when we started Project Green Hands in Tamil Nadu, the green cover of the state was only at 16.2%. The ideal green cover that India as a country should have for its tropical climate is 33%. 33% is, how to say, in one of the magazines I was reading in National Geography. So they were comparing the Earth's green cover equal to the skin of a human body. They were saying that if more than 33% of the skin becomes burnt or you have a skin disease, actually you will die. The system dies. The system shuts down if more than 33% of your skin is actually infected. So similarly, if less than 33% of the land is not under permanent green cover, the climatic conditions, the rainfall, the monsoons, the underwater groundwater table, and so many other environmental factors will just all go haywire. And that's the reason you have been hearing about various kinds of floods and droughts coming within a span of 12 months in many parts of the world. And especially in this part of the country, we are seeing that it is increasing in the last decade or two. So basically, when Project Green Hands started, we want to address this particular pinpointed problem that we want to increase the permanent green cover in the state to 33%. And if we were to do it, what we found is that by mathematical calculations, 114 million trees have to be planted to bring back the 33% green cover in the state. And when we took up this initiative, I was probably 19, 20 years old. And when Sadhguru was talking about 114 million, I was counting the zeros with my fingers and I couldn't count properly. And I was saying that, okay, even counting is so difficult. How are we even going to plant these trees and make them into trees? Planting a sapling is the most easiest job. And many of our forest officers and environmentalists always make fun of tree planting, that if all the trees survived, by this time we would have repopulated the entire earth with trees. That many trees have been planted in the earth. But the key thing is that how many do survive? And when Project Green Hands started, the whole idea is that Sadhguru told the lifeline of the project is that it has to be a community-driven tree planting program. It cannot be that Isha volunteers or Isha people go and directly plant trees. He said that no one should plant even one tree. That's the instruction we got. He said that you have to plant trees in people's minds and hearts. That is your job. And once you do that, transplanting them into the ground is a much, much easier job. So what Sadhguru did is that between 2000 to 2006, he worked on planting trees in people's mind, whether he went to the World Economic Forum or whether he attended the national level conferences and discussions or seminars. Wherever he goes, he just insisted that tree cover has to come back. Otherwise, there is no other way. So first, a conceptual buy-in from the larger community at the ground level, which means the common people in the rural villages, and also the political leadership, the bureaucratic leadership, the industrial leadership. All people have to first of all get aligned that this is a program that is for the well-being of all of us. So once that seed got planted into people's minds and heart, In 2006, when Project Green Hand started expanding, the groundwork has been already made by Sadhguru for us to go and easily talk about tree planting to everybody. And the biggest learning is that in the first few years, we were all excited. We want to plant trees. Okay, when we see a roadside, can we plant trees here? When we see a pond, can we plant trees on the bund? When we see empty land, can we plant trees? So everywhere we went and we started planting trees. We called the local people and we asked, do you want trees here? What kind of trees you want? They said something, we gave something, and they started planting. So 1 year down the line, I started traveling on my motorcycle to visit all these planting locations across the entire state. What I saw was that the survival rate was very poor. Very poor in sense, anywhere between 10% to 30 or 40% was the highest survival rate. And these saplings were produced by our volunteers in their backyards, in their farms and so on, with a lot of love and concern. And only 10 to 20% on an average is surviving. So that was a huge learning for us that this is actually not working. So where are we going wrong? So then we found that when you plant trees in public lands or in public spaces, which is roadsides or bunds of lakes or wastelands, which is not under utilization, nobody has the ownership on the trees which are getting planted. So to water a tree in a tropical climate and in a temperate climate is a very different affair. Watering is a huge activity and it's an expensive activity. So when trees are planted in common land, the benefits of the trees, whatever fruits or whatever, it is not that whoever is watering is alone experience the benefits of these trees. It's for the entire community. So actually the fundamental ownership of these trees to be grown was actually not there. And this is the first learning and the most important learning, which led to the change in strategy in the very next year in 2007, where we took one district as a model district, where the groundwater situation was very poor. And the farmers only grow rain-fed crops and dry crops. They don't have irrigation sources. So we went there and we wanted to pilot an initiative of agroforestry. So Kaveri Calling's real birth was in 2007 when we went into Pudukkottai district, one of the very dry districts of Tamil Nadu. And we started off in one of the villages where people were not cultivating for more than 6 months of a year because they didn't have any water. So they used to migrate everywhere for 6 months of the year, and for 6 months they come back and start planting and planting agriculture crops. So we went there and we taught about agroforestry to them. We brought model farmers who did it successfully. And then within a span of probably 3 years, we planted almost 1 million trees in this one district. And when we went year on year to see the survival rate, on an average, more than 80% of the trees survived. 20% mortality is something by nature it will happen because tree is a biological element and tropical countries have very harsh summers. So 20% mortality is something that even the departments or any program, they accept that 20% mortality is a very reasonable number. So what we were able to see is that when we gave trees, which will either give farmers fruits for them to eat and sell, or timber for them to use it as furniture in their house or sell it, or fodder for their cattle. If some benefit they're able to get from trees, then the fundamental buy-in from the farmers was very easy. Our objective is to ensure 33% green cover comes. And how does it matter whether it comes through mango trees or timber trees or some other trees? As long as trees are continuously planted and kept alive, we are happy with that. So this is the birthplace of understanding that without buy-in of the farmers who holds most of the land in India, farmers hold the majority of the land in the country. If they don't participate in any tree planting program, it could be on paper, but real success will not happen. So this is second learning that we had. The third learning that we got is that, okay, you have understood the problem statement and you know what is the solution. So how are you going to scale it up? What is the gap? So when we saw what is the real gap, farmers have lost the culture of planting a lot of agroforestry trees in the last 3 to 4 decades. So the availability of good quality planting material was not there, accessible near to all the villages in the state. So we found that it's a paramount importance that as a Project Green Hand should be able to supply quality planting material to all the farmers who are interested in agroforestry, and we should be giving it at a very, very nominal cost, so that the farmers are able to access it and take how many ever trees that they want to plant and plant it. So in the initial, so this is the third learning, that we have to supply good quality planting material, because the survival rate of the tree, 60% depends on the way it has been nurtured in the nursery. If it has not been nurtured properly in the nursery, the chances of death is 60% when it is planted. So the procedures in the nursery, the care that you take in the nursery decides the survival rate of the sapling after it is getting planted. So we started learning how to make nurseries. None of us knew how to make nurseries. We were just learning to know how to make nurseries. But this much was clear, that we should not be using any synthetic fertilizers or synthetic chemicals or pesticides or insecticides. We wanted to do it organic. So this is, makes the task much more difficult, because if you use urea or DAP or any of this nitrogen fertilizers, in 3 months you can produce the saplings. But for us, it takes 9 months to produce a sapling, almost like a human baby. So we have to invest that much amount of time to take care right from the seedling stage where it reaches 2 feet and we are able to distribute it to the farmer. It takes at least 9 months time. And for us to learn the intricacies of nurseries and scale it up, it was a huge learning. We learned how to manage large scale local women to get trained into nurseries so that they become skilled laborers rather than unskilled laborers. We wanted them to become skilled laborers. So on an average, around 400 to 500 women work with us for producing saplings every year. And when we started these nurseries, we were able to produce around 2 to 3 million trees a year. And today we are producing close to 12 to 13 million trees a year. That's the kind of capacity we have grown over a period of time. So this was the next learning. The consecutive learning was that, okay, now you have grown the saplings, you have identified the problem statement, you have the solution at hand, which you have proven over a decade. Now the thing is that Sadhguru was able to see that what Project Green Hands is doing is very cute, because it's very small and a small number of people are getting benefited. So you cannot really scale it up if Project Green Hands is going to go in the same direction it was going all the 10 or 12 years of work that we have been doing. So Sadhguru came up with Kaveri Calling. It was his brainchild that Kaveri Calling started. And he was able to see that fundamentally people in India are emotionally connected to the rivers. All the rivers in the country are named after a deity, a goddess. And they were actually treated as mothers. And the people who lived in the river basins were considered as the children of Kaveri, children of Narmada, children of Ganga. That's how it has been kept for thousands of years, not just the recent history. For thousands of years, this has been the lore of the country. And now these rivers are dying. And what it means is that when a river is dying, it means that the catchment area of the river, which is running in thousands of square kilometers, only if they are destroyed, you can say that the rivers are dying. So in that context, Sadhguru was able to look at the fundamental science, how rivers work and how rivers and groundwater systems interact with one another. If you need to have sustainable groundwater recharge, it is important that the rivers are running, because during the monsoon season, the rivers feed the groundwater systems, and during summers, the groundwater systems feed the rivers. So it is a two-way interaction. It is not a one-way interaction. And this fundamental science, Sadhguru didn't learn it through any textbook or any science class, but for him, it is a living reality. He says the stories about how he lived on a raft on the river Kaveri for more than 2-3 weeks together to just see and be with Kaveri as a life form. And those memories are something that he cannot forget. And these are memories that he's bringing back to us and inspire us that this is a living river that was there in our generation, and we have killed it within one generation. A river that has been flowing for millions of years, we are killing it in one generation, which he feels that it is not acceptable. And as a generation of people, Sadhguru wanted to make a very standing change and create a blueprint which will be replicable for all the tropical countries across the globe. So that is the genesis of Kaveri Calling. It is not just about reviving one river which is in our backyard. No, it is not about that. It is creating a blueprint. So at every thought level, at every technical discussion that we have with Sadhguru, he always sees that whether this methodology can be scalable across the world, across all the tropical world, then only he agrees or approves us to go ahead with those kind of strategies. So in short, I would say that this was the learning from Project Green Hands, which has given birth to Kavi Collection. So I would say Project Green Hands as the little elder brother to Kaveri Calling, which has given the wisdom and the learnings for us to really put our foot on the ground confidently. And the scale at which we are working is probably more than 20 times or 30 times the targets we had in Project Green Hands. But we are comfortable to face these huge targets, humongous targets, because the foundations have been very strong with Project Green Hands.
Yes, if I could, I'd just love to feedback that. I really appreciate that he started with implanting the importance of trees in people's hearts and minds. I just think that is brilliant. It just really encompasses bringing in the knowledge and everything that has to come afterwards. So I really love that connection, and the fact that he spent time on Kaveri River as a life force and a being in itself. And I just see so many aspects of this project, which I feel is so amazing and so well thought out and so fully encompassing. And I absolutely definitely see it as a blueprint going into other areas as well. I would love to help understand, or let the network understand, how does the project work? What is the actual kind of logistics of what you're doing on the ground to make this project work?
See, one thing is that to keep the project alive in the minds of everybody involved within the organization and outside the organization, Sadhguru has decided that no matter what happens, we will produce a certain amount of saplings, agroforestry saplings, in our own nurseries in organic methods, and we will be distributing it to farmers at a very, very subsidized cost of rupees 3. If I have to equate what it means, what 3 rupees means to Indian people, is that a cup of tea is 10 rupees. A cup of tea in a rural area, not in a city. A cup of tea in a rural area is 10 rupees. We are giving this sapling at 3 rupees. And we ensure that a farmer, when he comes and asks for saplings, we ensure that he's a farmer by collecting all the necessary proof that he's a farmer, where he's going to plant, how much trees he has, how much trees can he plant in the soil conditions and agroclimatic conditions, what species he can plant. And there is a technical team which will guide him when to plant, how to plant, and all these elements, and how to maintain it over a period of time. So in that context, there is a kind of an intrinsic system which will handhold farmers on a continuous basis for all the saplings that Isha provides. So the Project Green Hands history is that we have been supplying saplings to farmers for the last 15, 16 years. And now if we really have to reach the objective of 2.42 billion trees in a span of 12 years, it is no more a program that Isha can work or Sadhguru alone can do it. We need the government to back us completely with 100% support. Only this can really happen, because Isha will never be able to raise the funds or build the manpower that will be capable of planting 2.42 billion trees in 12 years' time. So when we say 12 years' time, why Sadhguru says 12 years' time is also very important. See, from his vision, he has been seeing life and Kaveri his entire life. And now he sees that the rate at which things are going, if you don't plant these trees in the next 12 years, the cost that it will take us to plant beyond 12 years is going to be exponentially high. It is not proportionally high. It is not the inflation index which will determine the cost of planting and survival of a tree. Because if the groundwater goes deep below a certain point, even tree roots cannot penetrate, which means you have to really make water available for these trees, which is going to be an expensive affair, like how Dubai and Saudi people are planting trees by building desalination plants and supplying water to trees. That kind of a solution is never a reality for India. So it has to happen in 12 years. We don't have a choice if we really want to make this happen. So in that context, for this to happen in this scale, unless the government comes on board, it cannot happen. So operationally, how do you bring the government on board? So we started seeing how to deal with government, because for the last 12 years, we have not had so much interaction with government or so much partnership with the government, because we've been running and we have been busy with our own programs. Always we were scarce of volunteers, always we were scarce of money, we were always scarce of resources. So we were trying to make ends meet and ensure that we get to plant certain number of trees. So we never actually worked with the government very closely, and that is also for various other aspects. But now when Sadhguru has taken up Kaveri Calling, the first decision that he had taken is that we have to work with the government. The government will have its limitations. At the same time, it is a huge machinery which has a huge potential to make things happen. So he did this Kaveri Calling rally to bring the political and bureaucracy leadership aligned to what needs to happen. And he demonstrated that the people really want this. So in every place where Sadhguru stopped on his motorcycle and talked about Kaveri, there were hundreds and thousands of farmers gathering and giving their support. And this was documented and given to the chief minister of both the states. And when this happened, the chief ministers took us seriously. This is not a fancy idea that Sadhguru is bringing. This is actually the real requirement on the ground, because Sadhguru is addressing the farmers. He's not addressing general public who are just using the tap water. He's addressing the farmers who are actually facing the brunt of the situation when Kaveri is dying. So when this happened, the government's alignment came on board, and very quickly, the first year, the Forest Department of Government of Karnataka said that we will produce 10 million trees for 2020. And if Isha or Kaveri Calling volunteers can inspire and bring the farmers on board, we are happy to distribute the saplings to them at a very subsidized cost of ₹3. So we said, we'll take it up. We will go district by district, village by village, and we will enroll farmers to come and ensure that they pick up the sapling. So this was the biggest commitment that we made to the government in 2020. The commitment we made was pre-pandemic, but the delivery has to happen post-pandemic. So that was the real challenge that we had to face, because the Forest Department started their nurseries and started producing the saplings from November 2019. And by the time pandemic and the lockdown happened, the saplings are already grown in the nursery. So they can't afford to waste the sapling that they have grown, and it's not a small number, they've grown 10 million saplings. And so we had this innate pressure, and also we were inspired. I mean, we want to make this happen, but at the same time, things are very difficult on the ground. So somehow we made it happen through social media. And we found that farmers' most preferred means of communication is Facebook and WhatsApp. So we exploited these technologies to whatever ways possible to ensure that farmer is made aware on the benefits of agroforestry, what kind of species are produced by the Forest Department, the benefits of these trees, and where it is given. So these level of details have been shared with farmers. More than, I think, 28,000 farmers called us during the last planting season, and we attended these calls within a span of a month or two, and we answered every call back by having a tracking system with our integrated voice response system. We were able to capture every demand and go back to the farmer and ensure that his concerns and his questions are addressed by a team of 120 volunteers who volunteered from their home during pandemic for a period of 2 to 3 months to ensure this service was provided to farmers. So on the ground, the biggest activity is to produce saplings in our own nurseries to ensure that we are able to teach farmers and small self-help groups to grow nurseries on their own. Second thing is that we want to enable the government machinery in a big way so that the government can actually scale up their tree planting programs. So the biggest bottleneck in the government is not funds. It is not the capability to produce saplings. The biggest bottleneck is that they don't have enough number of people to campaign about the benefit to the farmers in every village. So that is exactly the missing link that Kaveri Calling is trying to fill in and ensure that the government's investment in terms of their nurseries and incentives for every tree that is getting planted is coming to fruition at the end of 3 years. So when I say incentive, the fantastic thing that happened last year is that this Forest Department, when they produce this 7.5 to 10 million saplings, for every sapling the farmer planted, ₹125, close to €2, have been given as an incentive to the farmer to grow the trees for the next 3 years. And this is not a flat rate incentive. It is based on the survival rate that the forest department will monitor and then pay out to the farmers. So this will ensure that it is not just given as cash to them and they use it however they want. This is kept in a way that they will ensure that the trees are planted and grown for 3 years, and accordingly the incentives are given. So this incentive enabled us to quickly convert the farmers' mindset to tree planting, and this has facilitated us to quickly turn around huge number of farmers to take up plantation since last year. So these are the on-ground reality.
I think it's brilliant that you use like social media to reach people. And I also heard about a program, I think the government is helping to fund the women to go out and also be ambassadors and educate the different farmers about the types of trees and awareness about the program. And you can correct me if I'm wrong there, but that's what I understood. And I think that's, it just, yeah, every aspect sounds so important. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, please go on, please go on.
No, I was just really, really impressed. And I just feel so honored that Tree Sisters is playing a small role in all of this, because wow, the potential for this project and just bringing back the land and the river, and so important, especially in this time as we see so many news stories about different situations, you know, the fires in the USA that are happening right now, and flooding in Germany, and the climate is changing, and green cover is more important than ever before, and we do need to act now. So I'm just, so grateful for all of this. But if you wanted to go ahead and speak about the Women Ambassador, I think our audience would love to hear about that as well.
One thing is that, the sapling development is it's an activity with a lot of care and concern. It's like almost like bringing up a child, and it demands a certain feminine quality in the entire process. So though conventionally all agriculture activities are done with men as laborers, somewhere we felt that more than how much a person can carry in terms of load, what is more important is the subtlety with which they can approach life, the subtlety with which they can approach saplings and seedlings. So we felt that women have that quality as a default, quality. And that's fantastic for us to make use of in such a program. So if you look into all our nurseries, almost 90 to 95% of the people who are actually involved in making the sapling production are women. And we are not gender biased in any way, but at the same time, we see how it works on the ground. Sadhguru is never about empowering women or empowering men. He just sees that both are the same. And we have to make things happen in such a way it fundamentally works on the ground. You don't go with philosophy. You go with what works on the ground. So the reason what we felt is the best way to produce saplings is by involving more women in the process. When we go into convincing farmers on the ground, farmers' head calculate numbers. Okay, if I plant this many mango trees, how much money will I make? If I plant these teak trees or rosewood trees, how much money can I make? So this needs a certain kind of work where men are more good at these kind of things. And also in rural areas where the regions are very remote and the conditions are very tough in terms of moving between one place to another, we need that mobility where we feel that certain amount of men are involved in this kind of activities. So when we went into convincing larger farmers into tree plantation that was facilitated with the government scheme, we first went into a district where we went and met the concerned government officer and said that we want to reach every village in your district. And we want to reach them and train one person in every village who can further go and speak to every farmer and train the farmer on agroforestry models, the benefits of agroforestry. And these volunteers can collect the demand from every village by farmer name, land-wise, what number of trees, what species, how many trees they want to plant. And when we went with this particular officer said, we have a certain number of women volunteers across all these villages. We will call them for a training. And when they called them for a training, we saw that almost 90% of them are all women. And we thought it will be men. But we said, okay, let's do the training and see how it goes. The training went fantastic. all the women were excited. We conducted the learning process like a game instead of like a classroom session. We kept, I think Ma Nirmata will be best to tell how the training happened, because she was the one who designed this entire training as a game, so that the involvement of the participants is absolute. And it is not just a theory class, or it's not a boring classroom session. And we did this training in a fantastic way. And at the end of the training, the officer said, we have never seen such a training in our life. And we want Kaveri Calling to conduct this training every year. And we would like this to happen in all the districts of Karnataka, Kaveri Calling districts. So basically, we are seeing that the program scale up will happen in a very big way with these village volunteers. In that particular district, we saw a lot of women participation, and we are hoping to see more women participation in all the districts that we'll be entering in this coming planting season.
I'm more curious about the details that how she set it up, but it sounds like it's something that really they embodied, you know, the training that they learned, it's really enjoyed it and excited them, and they wanted to share it. And I think that is so key to actually getting more people involved and bringing that passion to the actual project. You know, it's more than
It was more like, how to say, they kept the tree species names in, like, written in small pieces of paper, and they put it in one basket. And for every tree species, we told that which are all the soil types in which these tree species can be planted. And then one group will take all the tree species saplings in their hand, and another team will have the soil. So the tree species will have to find their soil and go and house it as a group. So this was like one small exercise where we want to teach them what species can be planted for what kind of soil and what kind of climate. So to teach this, instead of teaching them methodically in a classroom setting, we kind of conducted a game where the technical aspect of the project will become a game, and it will stay in their head more, more clearer and firm.
Yes, absolutely. That's brilliant. Oh, just so much of this initiative has so many things that they're not just like a plan. They're just so embodying your essence and soul and spirit into what needs to be done. And I just see that the energy of the project as well is so amazing. And I know you were on the road and in the middle of getting to somewhere else. Is there anything else that you want our viewers, our donors to know that you really would like to share with them about this project?
See, this is not just an environmental program. It's very hard for me to speak about this particular aspect, because the number of farmers who have ended their lives in this country. Sadhguru says that if we put all the three wars that India fought in the last whatever century, the cumulative number of all the people who died in the war is still lesser than the number of farmers who have committed suicide. That is the harsh reality of agriculture in the country today, for various reasons. We don't want to go into the reasons, but that's the reality. And we could say that one of the most fundamental things is the climate. The second thing is that the soil fertility is declining rapidly, and the topsoil is getting washed away in floods and heavy rains, and which is also because of climate change and so on. So farmers are really struggling to put both ends meet for their family to even eat 3 square meals a day. And but at the same time, the opportunity is huge. If you get the right formula, farmers are making also good money. If they know how to proportionally put trees, grow fruits, grow food crops as an intercrop to all these trees, farmers have cracked so many different models which have been very successful. But these solutions have not really reached the larger population. When I go and speak to a farmer in the village, when I talk about a river, when I talk about soil, when I talk about global climate change, they really don't care. They are really worried whether my crop will survive this season, whether my harvest will fetch the right price for me to take some money back to my family and provide the basic minimum that I need to provide. So their mind and energy is completely oriented towards the fundamental economics in agriculture. So the whole program, though it is a large environmental initiative for the greater well-being of the entire world, but we have kept it in such a way that unless it makes economic sense to a farmer, all of this is theory. All of this is idealistic approach. Nothing will really work in scale. We can create small models of whatever sustainable village or this and that. But how many villages can you create? There are millions of villages in the country. What are we going to do? There are millions of villages across the globe. What are we going to do? So unless it makes economic sense, whether it is India or Brazil or Indonesia or any other tropical country which is fighting global climate change in a very hard way, I don't think the farmers are going to do whatever that is required for reversing these conditions. So this is not just about an environmental program. This is not just about a campaign. This is fundamentally touching the livelihoods of the population who have been living, depending on this reverse system for millennia. And we want to bring back that culture. It is not just about environment. It is about bringing back the culture. Revering trees as another life form. It is not just how much money you can make out of it. But it has to be balanced. You have to talk about life, and at the same time, you have to talk about the economics. Then only it works. So I just want to tell all of you that we really appreciate, and we are with a lot of gratitude to all the people who have supported through Tree Sisters to make this tree planting happen. It doesn't matter what is the scale, but we as volunteers, we get motivated when people like you come and really take interest in what is happening here, and you want to know what is happening rather than just donating. You really wanted to know what is happening. Why are we doing this? So this inspires us and keeps our fire going on. So we really thank all the people of Tree Sisters who have made this happen. And this has been a long-standing relationship. And for us, Tree Sisters are a very important partner. And we really wish and hope that we have a long-standing partner. Anything else you want to ask, Tara?
I just so much gratitude and appreciation in my heart for everything you've shared. I feel like this is the first time that I've heard this much, because I know I've been with the team for a while, and Project Green Hands was our original planning project. And just the scale of what you're doing, and just so many aspects of things that you've shared, I really, really genuinely appreciate this. And I know everyone who watches this will also appreciate it. I'm so grateful that you've taken the time. And yeah, I feel there's a connection there. Even though I'm 100 million miles away, I still feel that there's that connection, and I really want to participate and learn more and just be supportive for what the work you're doing. And I'm so very grateful. So yes, well, we'll have to have another meeting sometime in the future, and I look forward to that. But yes, thank you for being with us today and sharing everything you've shared, and best wishes with absolutely everything that you're doing there.
Thank you, Tara, and convey my special regards to Claire. I have not seen her in a long time. I think pandemic is keeping us apart. Yes. And my special regards to Claire and all of you. Thank you so much. And it's my pleasure speaking to you. We hope to meet soon.
Wonderful. Bye-bye. Thank you.